start from the beginning. Why you?
I think that Ambassador Haqqani chose me because at that moment, I mean, keep in mind today what we know is different than what we knew on May 9th. And at that moment, the concern was that if, for example, a communication got in the wrong hands or there was something that leaked out in the press or in the public domain somehow or the other in those days as we were executing the intervention, that I was a perfect fall guy, if you will, because, you know, I'm not particularly close to the administration in Pakistan today or the ISI or the Army. I've been a fairly strong critic of all three during the past, you know, 4 years that they've been around. And so I was the person that nobody would expect or believe that the government went to. And at the same time, I was the person that had the connections to be able to get the memorandum delivered in the United States to Admiral Mullen the right way, because I did not know Admiral Mullen myself. I told Ambassador Haqqani that when he first reached out to me. And but he also knew that I knew the people that did know Admiral Mullen and that we would be able to get it in there pretty quickly and quietly if we needed to. And the other issue was that, you know, because of my connections in Washington, we had to be able to do it fast enough to get the memorandum in the hands of Admiral Mullen 24 hours later, because the day after that, 48 hours later, there was going to be a very important meeting that Admiral Mullen was going to chair with the senior Pakistani officials to whom the message was, shall we say, politely going to be delivered that this is not the moment at which the types of stresses that we're hearing about, you know, movement against the civilian government and so forth, would be tolerated.
But after all this care and speed, Admiral Mullen says he didn't even pay attention to that memo.
Yeah, so this is, you know, that okay, if that's the case, that's the case. That has nothing to do with me. You know, Haqqani was the architect, Haqqani was the author. I was simply, you know, the typist, if you will, that day. I mean, literally the way this happened is that when we first started the conversation, the telephone conversation, I started taking notes. First it was, what's the problem? I mean, you could hear the stress in his voice at that moment. And so, you know, I asked him, I said, what happened? And he said, we have a serious problem. I need your help. Then he said, I need you to take some notes. So I then started taking notes. And then he started talking so fast that I put my BlackBerry on speakerphone and just stopped writing and you know, started typing, because I type reasonably quickly. And so I then just started typing whatever it was that he was saying so that I could get the notes encapsulated in such a way that there was no, you know, further, you know, there was no mismatch of what he said versus what it was that I had put down, because this was obviously important stuff that we were talking about. So, you know, in that sense, you know, the necessity for having a clear record there was there from the very early stages of what we were doing.
So how long have you known Ambassador Haqqani then?
I've known Ambassador Haqqani for about 12, 13 years. I mean, we've known of each other since the time of Benazir, because he was very close to Benazir and I, you know, interacted with her quite a bit. But I would say the real relationship began after 9/11, because when my, shall we say, media exposure became very high in the years right after 9/11, there were many times when I couldn't go and meet the multiple press obligations like the one I'm trying to do with you right now. And so what I would do is tell my friends in the media to go and talk to Husain, because he was a brilliant analyst and he understood the problems in that part of the world very well. And I was even asked by some, I won't say who, but by some interesting people that, you know, what would you think about him being an ambassador? And I thought he was a great selection. I mean, I'm not saying I had anything to do with it. I'm just saying that when I was asked what I thought about that, I always was very clear that I thought he was a great selection for taking that role on.
So you had a very long relationship, apparently a close relationship ever since 9/11. And he came to you because he thought that you were a trustworthy mediator in this whole thing. Mm-hmm. What prompted you to break that trust at this point?
It wasn't a breaking of the trust. I think I have to be very candid in telling you and your audience that, you know, the disclosure of the memo was not designed to bring this all out in the open. I wrote the op-ed piece in the Financial Times roughly 4 or 5 days after Admiral Mullen spoke in the Senate Armed Services Committee in his farewell testimony. And during that conversation, period of time, the conversation about Admiral Mullen's comments became so convoluted and twisted and negative and, you know, lambasting the admiral for, you know, taking the Pakistanis to task on what pretty much we all know to be a reasonable set of facts that he was basing his arguments on. And, you know, this was, for me, it was not right. And, you know, I'm an American. I was born and raised in the U.S. And when, you know, people get treated unfairly, there's something about us as Americans that stands up and says, no, we're not going to allow that to happen. And so the memo was written more as a defense of Admiral Mullen's statement that the ISI was, in fact, culpable. And the policy prescription that I had in mind was to take a much harder sanction against the ISI. And that, of course, got completely drowned out by the fact that in order to, you know, in op-ed writing, you have to be authentic. I'm not a book author like Ahmed Rashid. I'm not an ambassador like Husain Haqqani. I'm not a former foreign minister or president or whatever. And so my authenticity came from the fact that I had been involved in this effort to try and get the American government to assist in such a way that the civilian side of Pakistan's government would be able to eliminate a Section S of the ISI, for example. And that was contained in the memo. Now, in order to get that one line out of the memo, I had to disclose that there was a memorandum. There was no way that I could, you know, take one without the other. And that anecdote is what gave my piece the authenticity for me as an author to make the policy prescription that I had in mind. Now, the problem is that my policy prescription was completely ignored, and it's the Pakistani press that picked up on the fact that there was a memo that nobody knew about, that there was an intervention that nobody seemed to know about, and that there was a senior Pakistani diplomat. And that's something, you know, again, when you're writing the anecdote, I tried to write it in such a way that it really didn't disclose a lot. But unfortunately, it came out in a manner that people, you know, I think what people really picked up on was the fact that there was a memo that existed, the fact that there was a Pakistani diplomat. But then they also picked up on this phrase of the new national security team. And it is very important that your listeners understand that Haqqani's ambition was to go back and become Pakistan's new national security advisor and essentially act as the brain trust for all that would happen between the United States and Pakistan on counterterrorism issues beginning to end. That was the objective that he had in mind for himself, having constructed this entire scenario that we're talking about today.
Now, you have some very strong connections with, you know, the U.S. In the U.S. government. You know, James Allen Abramson is one of your partners, and even with the Clinton administration, you seem to know a lot of people. There have been allegations against you working for different governments, but I understand that you also have a strong relationship with the Indian and Pakistani administrations, that you, mm-hmm. when you go there, you get VIP treatment on both sides of the border.
Yeah, so I don't know how you define VIP treatment, but I have strong relationships in governments because, you know, the people who matter in government see me as an absolutely straight shooter. I say it as it is. One of the reasons that I'm so controversial in whichever word, whichever way you want to define that word, is because I don't take gump from anybody. I don't care if it's the president of the United States. When Bill Clinton lied about what they had done to capture or help or eliminate the threat from bin Laden, I took him to task. I'm an American citizen. I was arguing against my own president, who was a very close personal friend of mine for many, many years before I decided to take that on. You know, there's I don't regret doing any of those things. Benazir was a close friend before I saw that she was not honoring some of the private agreements that she had made with the United States about not, shall we say, dipping the hand into the national treasury periodically. When I wrote about her corruption problem in the Wall Street Journal in 1996, the result of that was that people stood up and said, wow, we didn't know that was going on. And it made the system in Pakistan much more accountable than it was prior to that. If people want to argue, sorry, let me just finish one point. If people want to argue that I am, treated like a VIP, that's fine. I don't care whether they think I'm a VIP or a DIP. This is irrelevant. I don't care whether people like my personality or don't like my personality. That, too, is irrelevant. What's relevant is what are the facts and why did all of this happen? And I would just like to make two simple points, and then I'll let you go on to the next question. The first is you have to ask yourself, why the cover-up? Why did Husain Haqqani, after this became public, make such a heavy effort to try and orchestrate first the Foreign Office's denial, which, of course, was true because the Foreign Office really didn't know anything in Pakistan. You know, this is an ambassador who theoretically, whose boss is the foreign minister of Pakistan. And that person, I forget his name, didn't know anything, Qureshi or something like that. He considered his boss always, and that's what he always said to me in all of our correspondence, our telephone calls, our BBMs, that the boss was Zardari. Now, the second point is, if there is a cover-up, that begs the question, what are they hiding? And that's the question that nobody in the media is focused on today. They're focused on my credibility. Well, here's my credibility. I'm a graduate of MIT. I went to Harvard Medical School. I have a degree in nuclear physics from the University of Virginia. I graduated magna cum laude at UVA and at the top of my class at MIT. I ran a Wall Street firm for 15 years before I decided to become a venture capitalist. You know, I live in one of the most beautiful regions of the world. I have five beautiful children. I have a beautiful wife. And I'm not interested in being involved in this problem
right
now.
Okay, so
I make sure that that lie is corrected.
Okay.
That's all.
You put up two questions yourself that you say nobody's asking. Number one, why the cover-up? And number two, what they're hiding? Would you like to answer these questions? What do you think?
I cannot, because the answers to those questions are so incendiary, and they bring out things that are not for me as a private citizen of the United States to talk about and to openly discuss. But I will tell you that it is impendent on a free, open, fair press, and that's what we're seeing in Pakistan happening right now, that as this stuff comes out in the open, as you bring people on and talk to people and try to get an idea of what's really happening here, what you're going to find out is that there was a cabal inside the Pakistani government that decided they were going to run things their way, and there were two people in that cabal, Husain Haqqani and Asif Zardari. And those two people decided they were going to do things in a certain way that nobody else was going to be a part of, and that is not the way democratic systems work. Ambassador Haqqani, who I consider a close friend, good friend, someone who's a really good guy, has been on the record all over the place in the last 24 hours, telling everybody that will listen that I have put the democracy of Pakistan at risk. But let me tell you something. He and his boss are the ones who put the democracy in Pakistan at risk by creating a unilateral structure that had no checks and balances, that had no accountability, that had no interest in understanding what the reality of governance is really all about in a pluralistic society. They just didn't get it.
Have you talked to Ambassador Haqqani ever since you wrote that op-ed piece?
Yes. About 2 minutes after it appeared, he called me and he said something to the effect of, can you please tell me somebody else that you know in the Pakistani government right now that you know well so that they don't all come looking for me, because I can be the only senior Pakistani diplomat that you're referring to. And after that, we've had many BBM conversations. We've had, you know, three or four very, very lengthy, probably more substantive and more indicative of what was really going on. All of that's coming out here in the next few days, because I just decided it was time for everything to be on the record and to make sure that everybody understood what really was going on here. You know, I was a simple typist that day. I made sure that the message got safely into the hands of Admiral Mullen. It was not my responsibility to worry about content. It was not my responsibility to make sure the Admiral read it, didn't read it, agreed with it, disagreed with it. All of what's going on right now is orchestration. I have in writing from Haqqani himself that the Admiral, during the course of that meeting that took place on the 11th of May, the Admiral was very proactive and agreeable to the ideas that were contained in the memorandum. And when you guys all see in the press what the 6 points were that they had in mind, in the next few hours it'll all be out in the open. When you see all of that, what you're going to see very clearly is that of the original seven policy prescriptions, one of them was agreed within the three-day period we were doing it. Of the remaining six, two of them have been done, two of them are in the progress, and two of them will never be accepted no matter what happens. Can't happen. It's not possible. And my point is, if you take five out of seven, that's a pretty good batting average, I would say, wouldn't you? I don't know if you play baseball or not, but that's a pretty good batting average.
Okay,
that's the bottom line.
You say you will see. So when will we see it? Where will we see it? How will we see it?
I don't know the details of that. I just know that before you wake up in the morning, you'll see it everywhere.
And we will see what? And will it come from you?
No. My understanding is that there are people in official circles that have decided to just release everything.
And that would be official U.S. circles?
Official circles is all I'll say.
Okay. So tell me a little bit more about your conversations with Ambassador Haqqani. Usually, what's the tone of those conversations
Always friendly. Even in the most stressful moments, we've been very civil and very polite. Our last communication by SMS or BBM, I forget which way it was, he told me point blank he would never trust me again, but he would always remain my friend and wanted to make sure that we left each other on civil terms. And my response to him was, you are my friend, you will always be my friend, but you made some very serious mistakes in judgment in trying to orchestrate these denials, because what you did was force me to put on the record what the reality was. The memorandum being mentioned in an op-ed piece was not the issue, as long as everybody agreed that it was just to be, you know, left right there in the op-ed piece. But instead, he had to make sure that they went and orchestrated all of these ridiculous denials. Look, they even entrapped the poor admiral in all of this. And then the admiral had to be reminded by the guy I sent the memo to that sent it to him that, you know what, actually we did all of this. And in fact, it was a pretty intense operation on that day. Don't you remember, Mike? And all of a sudden, Mike says, oh, yeah, I forgot about that. And then he sees all the email traffic again. You know, these are busy men who have a lot of responsibilities, and they certainly don't remember everything that goes across their desk. I can't remember what I did 3 days ago. So you know, the point I'm making to you is that these people had an enormous responsibility at that moment to make sure that the system was not being destabilized. And instead, what they did was a ruse, and that's why I say, the minute you know the answer to why is there such a heavy effort for a cover-up and what are they hiding, then you will understand why this was all done in the first place. That's it. That's all I can say.
And who's the person who reminded the admiral?
I'm not going to name that person.
Okay. Now, you mentioned in the beginning that you don't have relationships with the ISI or the army, but you were very close to Jahangir Karamat, weren't you?
Not particularly. I mean, I knew Jahangir. We probably met, three, four times in our whole lifetime. We used to, you know, when he was the ambassador in Washington, we used to keep in touch by email, but it was really social type stuff. I never did anything strategic with him. And, it was just sort of, you know, admiration from afar. I thought he was a good guy. And, you know, he was one of the few Pakistanis that thought I was a good guy. So we just left it at that.
Okay, now, I saw some allegations against you on some Pakistani channels today. I'm just going to ask you straight up, what's your relationship with the Indian government, particularly Mr. Vajpayee?
Yeah, so in the late fall, early winter of 1999, just after the coup took place, Indian intelligence chief, he was at that time the deputy intelligence chief. Later, he became the intelligence chief of India. Chandra Sahay approached me through Andrea Koppel, Ted Koppel's daughter, in Washington, to come and help them to understand how we might be able to use the advent of Musharraf coming to power as a possible breakthrough that would, you know, enable peace to come to Kashmir, maybe even a permanent solution, and break the ice between India and Pakistan structurally. And at that time, my mother knew General Musharraf quite well, and a number of the people around him. So there was an assessment made that I was, again, there was a perfect example of why I was chosen as an interlocutor, because I was an American of Pakistani origin whose father had worked early on in the nuclear program, and I was an American close to the president at that time. And so it was a perfect example of the Indians being able to say, yeah, but how could you imagine we would use a guy like that? You know, he's everything we don't want anywhere near us. And so it was a perfect, opportunity to quietly execute some diplomacy. And so we succeeded in getting the Mujahideen in Kashmir to agree to a roughly 2.5-3 month long ceasefire. During that time, I met frequently with Yasin Malik and a number of the other key Kashmiri leaders. And then we were able to bring the Kashmiris and the Indians together. In my hotel room, in fact, I brought Chandra Sahay and Yasin Malik together in India. And we, were able to get people to calm the waters a little bit. Now, of course, Kashmir has gone up and down since then, but there was a moment there at which we were very, very close to a permanent solution. And Musharraf was supportive of it and was ready to do it. And I met with Musharraf quite often at that time in the early days. These are not allegations. I don't know how you call these allegations. I think that's the wrong word. If people want to say I'm close to the Indian government, I'm equally close to the Pakistani government. If people want to say I'm close to the Israeli government, I'm equally close to the American government or the Chinese government or to the British government or the French government. I'm an international businessman. We have contacts all over the world. That's the way we run our lives. So I think these kind of things are just irrelevant. People talk about that stuff as if there's some gotcha in that, and it's all nonsense. That's just, they're trying to find some way to discredit the messenger instead of looking at what the facts are and trying to understand why is this all such a big deal. Obviously, a month and a half after this memo came, after the op-ed came out, the reality is that we are now at a point where there may be some very significant structural changes in the way the operating dynamics of that country works. And why is that there? Because all of a sudden, one guy decided to stand up and say, all right, well, if everyone else is going to lie about what's going on, I'll just make sure the truth is out there in such bold fashion that nobody can deny it. And that's exactly what I've done. And I'm very, very firm about why I did it. And I'm very firm about the fact that it will be beneficial to Pakistan in the long term.
When you were doing it, did you mention it to Haqqani that it might be a bad idea? Because you seem to think it was a bad idea.
You're talking about the memo. What he was writing in the memo?
Yes.
No. That wasn't for me to make a comment about, because you have to understand that I really, this was one of the few interventions in which I did not inject a single personal opinion, view on what should be said, or anything other than the operational mechanics of making sure that the message got safely, quietly, without detection from the ambassador's mouth to the admiral's hands. That's it. So I had no intention of that type whatsoever.
Thank you very much.
میں نے بیان دیکھ لیا ہے منصور اعجاز صاحب کا اور اس کا جواب بھی دے دیا ہے میں نے کوئی میمورینڈم جیسا کہ وہ کہہ رہے ہیں نہ لکھا نہ پڑھا نہ پہنچایا اب اس کے بعد مسئلہ یہ ہے کہ وہ کچھ بھی کہتے رہیں اس کی کوئی اہمیت میرے نزدیک نہیں ہے حکومت پاکستان کی جانب سے اس معاملے کی پوری تحقیق ہونے پر مجھے کوئی اعتراض نہیں میں صدر مملکت کے حکم کے مطابق پاکستان پہنچنے والا ہوں اور صدر مملکت کو یہ حق ہے کہ وہ فیصلہ کریں کہ میں سفارت کے فرائض سر انجام دوں یا نہ دوں لیکن مجھے اس بات پر شدید اعتراض ہے کہ پاکستان میں بعض عناصر پہلے سے ہی ایک پروپیگنڈا مہم چلائے ہوئے ہیں بہت سارے لوگوں کو میرا امریکہ میں پاکستان کا سفیر ہونا اس لیے پسند نہیں تھا کہ ایک عرصے کے بعد پاکستان کا ایک سویلین سفیر جو ہمیشہ سے پاکستان میں جمہوریت کے لیے وکالت کرتا رہا ہے وہ مقرر ہوا تھا میرے صدر زرداری کے ساتھ قریبی تعلقات ہیں اور انشاءاللہ رہیں گے صدر زرداری اور ان کی جماعت اور پاکستان کی موجودہ حکومت میں شامل تمام سیاسی جماعتیں اور وہ ساری سیاسی جماعتیں جن کو پارلیمنٹ میں نمائندگی حاصل ہے سب پاکستان میں جمہوریت کی بالادستی کے لیے کوشش کر رہی ہیں اور بطور سفیر ہم نے بھی یہی فریضہ سر انجام دیا ہے کہ پاکستان میں جمہوریت کی بالادستی رہے لیکن پاکستان میں جمہوری حکومت کو بچانے میں نہ تو کسی امریکی فوجی کا کوئی کردار ہو سکتا ہے نہ ہونا چاہیے اور یہ الزامات تمام کے تمام من گھڑت کسی سازش کے تحت کیے گئے ہیں لیکن ان الزامات کی اہمیت اسی وقت ہوتی ہے جب لوگ الزامات کو اہمیت دیں یہ کیا عجیب بات ہے کہ ایک امریکی شہری جو یورپ میں رہتا ہے وہ یہ کہتا ہے کہ مجھ کو پاکستان کے سفیر کو جو واشنگٹن میں موجود رہا ہے اور جس کے بارے میں خود پاکستان کے میڈیا میں میرے مخالف اور حکومت کے مخالف لوگ کہتے ہیں کہ اس کے امریکہ کی حکومت میں اعلیٰ ترین سطح پر بڑے قریبی تعلقات ہیں اس کو اس شہری کی ضرورت تھی امریکی شہری کی ضرورت تھی کوئی میمورینڈم امریکی حکومت تک پہنچانے کے لیے یہ میرے خیال میں ایک مضحکہ خیز بات ہے غیر منطقی بات ہے اور حیرت ہے کہ اس کو بعض لوگوں نے اتنا بڑا اور اتنا اہم بنا دیا ہے شکریہ
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.